بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا كريم. By the grace of Allah تبارك وتعالى, we come together today to discuss a matter to which Allah's Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself give immense importance to in his book عَزَّ وَجَلْ and in his sunnah عليه الصلاة والسلام. And that being the topic of the heart. And that being the topic of the heart. When you look at تَزْكِيَةُ النَّفْسِ, and that's the title of the class here, purification of the soul. Usually the ulama, they discuss the concept of the soul herein, and they also discuss the concept of the heart. The concept that we are due to discuss in this series of lectures is the concept of the heart. What exactly is it that a heart needs to nourish itself? What exactly is it that corrupts an individual's heart? What is it that one needs on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis, to keep his heart rejuvenated and alive? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, a lot of times when he speaks of an individual, he might be alive physically, but he says he's dead. As the Prophet ﷺ said in his hadith, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ كَمَثَلُ الْحَيِّ الْمَيْتِ. The example of the individual that remembers his Lord and the example of one that doesn't do such is the example of one that is alive and another that is dead. So they are those hearts that are absolutely dead. So the concepts that inshallah ta'ala we'll be discussing in this series is mainly pertaining to the heart. Now before we get into the series though, however, we need to look at what exactly is it that ilm al-tazkiyah is all about. First thing is the fact that Tazkiyah comes from the word zaka, which means essentially to grow larger and to grow purer. So when you say ilm al-tazkiyah, the science of tazkiyah, what you're trying to say is that it's that fen or that science in which a person learns how to have his soul grow closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how to have that same soul become pure of all the illnesses that are pertaining to a soul. So that's what in essence tazkiyah is. Then that's where the relation of the root word comes into play as well. Then you need to look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word tazkiyah in the Quran. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word tazkiyah in the Quran. Because that will give you an understanding of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means by at-tazkiyah. So if you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times he attributes the word tazkiyah to himself. At other opportunities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes the word tazkiyah to his slave. And other times, you'll find him attributing it to Allah's Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So all of this has reasoning to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. The one who has purified his soul, verily he has become prosperous, victorious. So what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is over here trying to say is that an aspect of tazkiyah also entails the fact that an individual himself will have to put effort into purifying his soul. So it doesn't just come like that. You have to put effort into it. لَوْلَا الْمَشَقَّةُ لَسَادَ النَّاسُ كُلُّهُمُ الْجُودُ يُفْقَرُ وَالْإِقْدَامُ قَتَّالُ. If it wasn't for hardship, every single individual, as the poet says, would have become a leader. Great, sad. الْجُودُ يُفْقَرُ. If you want to become generous, then this will lead to poverty, because it's difficult to be generous. So it requires difficulty, or incurring that difficulty on the part of the slave. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over here, He attributed to the slave. He said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَ. Prosperous is the one that purifies his own soul. You have to sit by yourself moments in the day, ponder all of the moments that you disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to sit by yourself, or as you walk the street, you have to watch what you do. When you have an opportunity to take a gaze and a glance, stop yourself. It requires effort on the slave's part. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, He says, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ مَا زَكَى مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ. If it wasn't, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributing it to Himself. He said, well, if it wasn't for the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala solely, and His mercy, مَا زَكَى مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ, none of you would have been able to purify themselves. بَلِ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who purifies the soul of whomever He pleases. That soul that is calling to evil, that heart that continuously drives an individual to sin, away from bliss, Allah is the one who can solely give tawfiq to an individual to protect his heart from such, and protect his or her soul from such. But at the same time, as we said earlier on, there has to be effort on the part of the individual as well. You know, if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's tawfiq, you gotta work for it. You gotta work for it. And it doesn't stop there. As we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also attributes it to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And that being, in the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِرُوهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. Take, O Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, from their wealth, sadaqah, as in zakat. تُطَهِرُوهُمْ, you'll purify with them with this zakat that you took from their money. وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا, and also you purify them because of the zakat that you took from them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in another verse, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِنَا وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ, about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, He recites upon you our verses, and at the same time, He purifies your souls for you. So that leading us to another concept, and that is the fact that an individual also has to have someone that he looks to help him purify his soul. Someone that he looks to help him purify his soul. Because the Sahaba, they always used to look at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Whenever the iman is low, you know, that Sahabi that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he said, you know, when we meet you, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, it's as if our iman is at the pinnacle. And when we go away from you, our iman starts to grow low. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what did he say? He said, if you were to be on that same state that you are on when you meet me, لَصَافَحَتْكُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, verily the angels would have shook your hands. Because it's a really high state of iman that you're on. So at a moment, you might be at the pinnacle of your iman. And that's when you meet a person of piety. At another, you might be really low. And that's the reason why you have to continuously go towards the ulama and the du'at. And that's why some of the ulama, when they said that, when you look at the intermingling that an individual should be doing, he said amongst them is intermingling, the example of which is the example of nourishment. The example of which is the example of nourishment. Just as you need your food, your drink, your, you know, all of that, your nutrition, similarly you need to meet the people of knowledge. Similarly, you need to meet the people that call to good. Also, that you, so you can be nourished. And the more a person does this, the more an individual does such, the more and more purity he'll find in his heart, and his soul, and his mind. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, most, the purest of human beings, say, وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ, and he purifies your souls for you. Because he knew how to do that. Similarly, the inheritors of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they also know how to do that. Maybe not as well as the Prophet, but they still know. So we should make it a habit on a weekly basis, be it on a monthly basis. You owe it to yourself, brother. You owe it to yourself, sister, that you come to the masjid. There's halaqat ilm all the time. And you establish that which the Prophet ﷺ, when he said, إِذَا مَرَبْتُمْ بِالْيَالِ الْجَنَّةِ فَارْتَعُوا, whenever you go by the gardens of heaven, then graze therein. They said to the Prophet ﷺ, what are these gardens of heaven, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ? The Prophet ﷺ said, حِلَقُ الْعِلْمِ or حِلَقُ الذِّكْرِ, the circles of knowledge. So you have in the masajid all over, especially in a place like Toronto, a lot of blessings. You go to other cities all across North America, you don't find as many حِلَقُ الْعِلْمِ, circles of knowledge. So since you have that, you owe it to yourself, brother, you owe it to yourself, sister, to come and take advantage of these. Also that you can lead a life of an individual that is working towards purifying himself and his soul. So, as we said, there's different aspects to it. The first of those is the individual himself should be working towards helping his own soul purify, get purified. And also, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have that done. And then looking to guidance from the people of knowledge on how to do such. And then looking to the people of knowledge for guidance on how to do such. And then we want to discuss another concept, and that is the concept of why is it that it is extremely important for an individual to focus on his or her heart. The answer is very simple. The answer is because of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah's Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam gave immense importance to the heart in the Quran and the Sunnah. Could some of the brothers come on this side? So my neck doesn't get strained in one direction. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily the gaze, the sight, والبصر, and also the hearing. And thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, والفؤاد, and also the heart. كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ, every single one of these, كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا, an individual will be taken to account for them. السبع, the sicknesses or the problems or the illnesses or the calamities of the hearing, there are many. Like hearing, that which does not please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَهُ الْحَدِيثُ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُ الْحَدِيثُ. And from people, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that purchase or barter لَهُ الْحَدِيثُ, a vain speech. And the ulama and the sahaba, they explain this vain speech to mean what? Music. Every day. And then we try to explain to ourselves, what exactly is it that is wrong with this music? What's not wrong with it, dear brother, dear sister? It's haram. It's haram. Ibn Abbas, he explained this verse over here to mean that it is referring to music, lahu al-hadith, vain speech. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, towards the end of time, there will be people from my nation, يستحلون الحرير والحرى والمعازف. There will be people that will try to justify الحرير, silk, to wear in their garments. والحرى, and zina, fornication. They'll try to justify that it's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he continued to say, المعازف, and also instruments that are used for music. So music is muharram shar'an, no doubt about it. Why is it that we lie to ourselves and try to explain away all of the ahadith about which the Prophet ﷺ, in which the Prophet ﷺ talked and spoke about music? What's wrong with it? I believe, who are you to believe anyways? Who are you to believe? I think, who are you to think? لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله وبين يدي الله ورسوله. Do not put your opinion forth in front of the opinion of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, who are you to think? Oh, I have a PhD. Oh, I'm a doctor. How many of you are doctors? Nobody's a doctor. Alhamdulillah. Oh, I'm a doctor. I'm a physician. I'm a physio, wizio, wizio. He's got a distinction so difficult, you can't even pronounce it. Ya akhi, you might be a physio-isio-ishan, but the reality is, you don't know anything about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't know anything about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keep it quiet. When I come to your office, and I seek help in how to fix my body, then tell me what to do. But since you didn't take those 4 years of your life, or those 6 years of your life, and study the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then shh, chill, relax. This is not your business. Really. That's why some of the sahaba, when they went on an excursion, and one of the sahaba, he went in the state of major ritual impurity. And he had a wound on his head. He had a wound on his head. So he asked some of the other sahaba, he asked them, هَلْ تَجِدُونَ لِي رُخْصَةً? Do you find an excuse for me for making ghusl? Because if I was to make ghusl, it's extremely cold and the wound will get wet and the chances are I'll die. He said, no, you gotta pray. But these weren't the ulama from amongst the sahaba. So he made, took a shower. Yeah, he did. He took a shower. And when he took that shower, he went back home. And on the way home, he prayed his salah, he died, he passed away. Whereas in this kind of a situation, for those of you that know, tayammum is enough. So when they came to the Prophet ﷺ and they explained to him such and such took place, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ, what do you think he replied? So your Sahaba, Ashabi kan nujum, my Sahaba are like glowing stars. What do you think he said? He said, قَتَلُوا, they've killed him. قَتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do the same to them. فَإِنَّمَا شِفَاءُ الْعِيِّ السُّؤَالِ, for verily, verily the cure of ignorance is that you ask. The cure of ignorance is that you ask. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And who do you ask? Ask the people of knowledge if you didn't know, and if you don't know. So, when you have a problem, when somebody opinionates in a field that you may have studied for 20 years, or 15 years, or you've been working on for all your life, then yeah, Ahlul Ilm will have a problem when you start opinionating about things that you don't know about. That's why Imam al-Shafi'i, rahmatullah alayhi, used to say that I disputed and argued with a layman. And he beat me. And when I disputed with people of knowledge, they weren't able to beat me. Why? Because there are certain prime principles that you just won't understand. That's what he's trying to say, Imam al-Shafi'i. Certain things you just won't understand. Just as to become a doctor, you have to do pre-med. And if somebody starts explaining to you how to do surgery and you haven't even been through pre-med, it'll be difficult for him or her to explain. A lot of times you have somebody ask a question. You have somebody ask a question and the speaker begins and, you know, starts to answer that question. And he gives a couple of prefaces before he answers the question. And the person that's asking the question, he says, get, you know, cut the slack, get to the point. He can't get to the point, because the point requires a lot of prefaces. You're going to have to hear the whole answer for you to understand why he says what he says, or why she says what she says. So coming back to the verse here, إن السمع والبصر والفؤاد كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا. Verily, your hearing, and amongst hearing is eavesdropping. That's a sin. Haram. Allah's Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, من استمع إلى حديث قوم وهم له كارهون صب في أذنه الآنك يوم القيامة. Yeah, so whoever listens to the speech of a group of people and they don't like for this individual to listen to the speech, صُبَّ فِي أُذُنِهِ الْآنُكُ, on the day of judgment, smelted iron will be poured into this individual's ear, because he listened to people when they didn't want him to listen. What, he listened to people when they didn't want him to listen. It's a simple thing, but this is the reward and recompense for such an individual. والبصر, and also the gaze. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets to the heart. And also the heart. As in even the actions that an individual has within his heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be asking about. That's why they have something called ghibat al-qalb, doing backbiting with the heart. So not only does an individual have to purify his tongue, his hearing, his eyesight, rather also an individual, Allah is saying over here, has to purify the heart. كل أولئك, every single one of those things, كان عنه مسؤولا, an individual will be taken to account for, even the heart. In positively and negatively. If a person has great intentions, Allah's Prophet ﷺ said, نِيَّةُ الْمُؤْمِنِ أَبْلَغُ مِنْ عَمَلِ. Or it was said that he said that. That the intention of a believer reaches even further out than his actions. So if a person has great intents, he'll be rewarded for that. But if a person has evil intents, may or may not be rewarded for that, but it will turn into action sooner or later if he doesn't purify. And in another hadith, Allah's Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً. Verily, in the body is a piece of flesh. إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ. Whenever this piece of flesh becomes pure and reformed, the entire body along with this piece of flesh becomes reformed as well. And he continued, he said, whenever it becomes corrupt, the entire body, along with this piece of flesh, also becomes corrupt. So over here, again, the Prophet ﷺ stresses the importance of an individual taking his heart to account. Because if this heart becomes reformed, then the body becomes reformed as well. Because the heart is the place that an individual thinks. The heart is what leads all the rest of the body faculties to do what they do. So if one can put his efforts towards the reformation of this heart, then the rest of the body in turn will also become reformed. That's why whenever you have a problem, you have to go to the root of the problem to fix it. And the root of the problem over here is the heart. Do you not see that between kufr and iman is the heart? If a person says the statement of kufr, when he is dragged into it, or she is dragged into it, forced into it, and his heart is at rest, what happens? Is he a kafir? He's not. So it is the heart again and again. Allah's Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do you not see the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. On that day, not wealth, nor banun, nor children will help an individual. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except an individual that comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and brings along with him a saved heart. Saved from what? Saved from the calamities of the heart. Saved from kufr, because that's within the heart. Saved from an individual leading a life of desires, because it starts within the heart. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. Wealth nor children will be beneficial on that day. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Except an individual that brings to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a pure, a saved heart. So here we are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah's Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam surely did put a lot of emphasis on this heart. Surely did. So now, we have to look to the heart. Because Allah put emphasis on the heart. And it is also important for an individual to look at the heart, because if he looks to the heart and he's able to figure out the mechanism and the way the heart is designed, it gives him the opportunity to seek to have a political approach with his heart. There's times where your heart is longing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our hearts those hearts. There's times where you have your heart far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you understand when that occurs, then it becomes easier for you to deal with the heart in the correct manner. And that's why Ibn Mas'ud, rahmatullah alayhi, radiyallahu anhu, he used to say, "Inna li hadhihi al-qulub shahwatan wa iqbala." Verily, these hearts of yours has a moment in which it desires the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it longs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Iqbala. وَإِنَّ لَهَا فَتْرَةً وَإِدْبَارًا. And there are also times when the heart has a fatra. It no longer longs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِدْبَارًا. And it turns away from the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are those times. And Ibn Mas'ud continued, he said, فَخُذُوهَا. So then take advantage of it. عند شهوتها وإقبالها وذروها عند إدبارها. So then take advantage of your heart when you know it longs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ramadan is here. A lot of our hearts long for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Ramadan. And you don't know, and I don't know, when after these moments of longing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the heart would long again. Ibn Mas'ud is telling you over here that when you have this feeling, this gut feeling, that you want to be closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take advantage of this feeling. Because you don't know when this feeling is due to come back again, or even if it will. Or even if it will. And when it becomes difficult for an individual to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you find your heart away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Ibn Mas'ud is saying, give yourself a break. Give yourself a break. But again, most of us, we're always on a break. So I don't want anybody going home and thinking that I don't feel like it. When I pick up the Quran, I'm not with it, so just put it away. Most of us are always on a break. What he's trying to say here is, when you've done your quota of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you've set yourself some limits and you've already finished that, then don't overdo it. And that's why Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, رُوحُ عَنِ الْقُلُوبِ تَعِ الذِّكْرِ. So give your hearts rest sometimes. And that's when they will begin to comprehend what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. But again, this doesn't go for an individual that has never even exhausted his heart in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at Zaynab radiallahu ta'ala anha, standing the night in worship. And then when she can't worship anymore, she has a string that she reclines on so that she can continue to stand. So it's not referring to one of us necessarily, that don't even worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all, or merely. And here's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw Zaynab, he said, ليقم أحدكم نشاطه فإذا فتر فليقعد. That one of you should stand only the amount of time that he finds himself ready to do so. But the problem is, most of us don't even stand the night. فَإِذَا فَتَرَ فَلْيَرْبُدْ. And whenever he gets tired, then let him go and take a rest. So we say, after Isha we're tired. Bismillah. At least half of the hadith is being put to practice. It's khayr. لا والله, it's not khayr. It's not. So when I say that what Ibn Mas'ud is saying over here, وَذَرُوهَا عِنْدَ إِدْبَارِهَا, and whenever your heart doesn't really feel attuned to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then leave it off. What he's trying to say is, if you are from those people that are actually worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at the example of our dear Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Worshipping the night, standing up in the morning, and explaining the ahkam to the people. Standing up the morning and planning for excursions. Standing the morning, discharging the armies. And at night, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to an extent that his feet begin to swell. And when they asked the Prophet ﷺ, why is it that you do that, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ, who is the greatest of beings? Everything before that he had committed, which he hadn't, had been forgiven. Everything after that he had committed, which he hadn't as well, was forgiven. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Should I not be a thankful slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Should I not be a thankful slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, here's the example of Zainab, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Here's the example of our dear Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Again, the best of creation. وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَ قَطُّ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. Better than you, more perfect than you, O Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Hassan ibn Thabit says, more perfect than you, لَمْ تَرَ قَطُّ عَيْنِي. My eyes have never seen. وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ. More beautiful than you, women have never bore. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ. You've been created free from every عيب, every defect. كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. It's as if you, O Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, have been created just as you pleased. وَإِنَّ الرَّسُولَ لَنُورٌ يُسْتَضَاءُ بِهِ مُهَمَّدٌ مِنْ سُيُوفِ اللَّهِ مَسْلُولُ. As the Ka'b says, Ka'b, to the face of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, verily, the Prophet of Allah ﷺ is a light. And he's saying this to the face of the Prophet ﷺ, يُسْتَضَاءُ بِهِ. You seek to illuminate your own life with. Here is the example of the Prophet ﷺ. Is there someone who seeks to illuminate his life with? Is there? So, when Ibn Mas'ud is saying what he's saying, he's not referring to necessarily one of us, or most of us at least. He's referring to those people that have exhausted their lives in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why he said, وَرَوِّحُ عَلِي رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ. He said, رَوِّحُ عَنِ الْقُلُوبِ. Give yourselves the break, but if you're always on a break, So when we understand that, we then look at another hadith of the Prophet ﷺ discussing the same concept of how an individual can have a political approach with his heart. He knows how to manipulate his heart in the right way. And that is this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, فَإِنَّ لِكُلِّ عَابِدٍ شِرَّةً. Verily, every slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has something called a shirra, which is like a rancor, a bitter period. وَلِكُلِّ شِرَّةٍ فَتْرَةً. And for every shirra and every bitter period that a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes through is only there for a little while. فَإِمَّا it's either إِلَى بِدْعَةٍ وَإِمَّا إِلَى سُنَّةٍ. It's either at this point that the heart will begin to become inclined towards a bid'ah, an innovation. Or the heart at this point will become inclined towards a sunnah. So when you recognize your heart, and you recognize when exactly is it that your shirra comes, your bitter part, bitter portion. Every now and then we complain to ourselves and we say that my iman is really low. That's what the Prophet ﷺ is talking about. When you recognize when that occurs, that's when you can manipulate your heart and have a political approach with your heart and lead it to a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. There are certain sunnahs of the Prophet ﷺ that are not so tiring. So at that point, an individual can use his heart and also occupy it in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by doing something that is not as tiring. By maybe visiting a cousin that's sick. This time, in this manner, you get to fulfill the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ by doing something good and occupying every single one of your moments of life in that which is good, because you only have a few moments. And that's why one of the poets, he says in his beautiful statement, he said, أذان المرء حين الطفل يأتي وتأخير الصلاة إلى الممات دليل أن محياه يسير كما بين الأذان إلى الصلاة. So the adhan of an individual in the ear of a child وَتَأْخِيرُ الصَّلَاةِ إِلَى الْمَمَاتِ and delaying صَلَاةِ الْجَنَازَةِ until the individual dies. It's alluding to the fact that all you have between your entire life is like كَمَا بَيْنَ الْأَذَانِ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. It's like that which is between an adhan and a salah. A very small portion of time. A very small portion of time indeed. And that's why Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, 6 entire years he says about himself, I did nothing but study. And when I say nothing but study, I really mean it. 6 entire years of his life, all he was doing was walking around with a book in his hand. And that's why he reached where he reached. And he only died when he was 45 years old. And there's not a masjid in the world probably that has this book, Riyad al-Salihin. Six entire years. He used to say that when I would feel a jolt of slumber, I would just recline on my book and then continue onwards. Didn't used to go to sleep. Even just to calculate, you yourself, think about what the Prophet ﷺ used to do in his life. Just to calculate. You think he used to get a lot of time to sleep? عليه الصلاة والسلام. How big is the night? I mean, you know, you can have barakah, but you know. But you think he used to have a lot of time to sleep? Tell me. If he's standing a third of the night in prayer, if he's standing the third of the night in prayer, how many hours is that? Somebody tell me, somebody do the math. Where is the mathematicians? Huh? 4 hours. 4 hours. If he's reading Surah Al-Baqarah in Al-Imran at night time, that in and of itself, which is sometimes to be just 2 rak'ahs of his, that in and of itself is how long? About 3 hours. And he was praying how many rak'at every night? 11, 13, alayhi salatu wasalam. Where do you think he had time to sleep? He barely had time to sleep. Because he recognized this principle that all you have in your life, the example of it is the example of that which an individual has between an adhan and to a salah. And that's why you start off with the adhan in your right ear and you finish off with salah. And you're done. So, when you recognize the shibra, the bitterness that a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes through time to time, then you will be able to manipulate your heart to direct it to a sunnah that's lighter on this heart. That's why, as I said, a lot of us always, they're complaining to each other and saying, my iman is weak. Your iman is weak, the way for you to bring it back to where it used to be is to do something good. But maybe your iman is weak, so you can't pray the night. Maybe your iman is weak, you can't pray all your sunnah. Maybe your iman is weak, you can't read too much Quran. But is it weak to an extent that you can't even give sadaqah if you have some money? Or just smile at your brother? Or say some nice words to your parents? These things, they don't require that sort of strength. Of course, it depends on person to person. So for you to purify your heart now and bring it back to that same level, you need to know how to manipulate your heart and have a political approach with your heart. So this way, if you were to do these actions that are easier on your soul and on your mind, you do them and slowly you'll bring yourself back to that same state where you can now go back and pray the night in prayer. You can now go back and pray all your sunnah. You can now go back and sit for hours and read the Quran again. Because you've always been cleaning your heart in other ways. Because verily the hearts, they do rust. Allah's Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّ الْقُلُوبَ لَتَصْدَعُ كَمَا يَصْدَعُ الْحَدِيدُ. Verily, the hearts, they become rusty just as iron becomes rusty. And then he asked the Prophet ﷺ, وَمَا جَلَأُهَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What exactly is it that brings these hearts back to life, O Prophet ﷺ? So, when they asked the Prophet ﷺ, what exactly is it that brings these hearts back to life? He said, ذِكْرُ الْمَوْتِ. He said, remembering death constantly. Thinking about the fact that life is extremely short. وَتِلَاوَةِ الْقُرْآنِ. And also reciting the Qur'an. Also reciting the Qur'an. So the point of the matter here is that the hearts, they can become rusty. They can become rusty. And that's why the ulama, they divided the hearts into three different types of hearts. The first of those hearts is al-qalb al-sahih, or al-salim, about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an,
يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ.
On that day, no wealth, no children will be of any benefit to anybody. Except what? Except an individual that brings a saved heart. And we talked about the saved heart earlier on. We talked about the saved heart, the same saved heart that is saved from the sicknesses of the heart. Hasad, being jealous of your peers. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, دَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ دَاءُ الْأُمَمِ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Verily, the sicknesses of all the nations before you has slowly made its way to you as well. And what did he say, the Prophet ﷺ? He spoke about hasad and shahna, hatred towards one another, and jealousy. And jealousy. So, amongst, you know, the sicknesses of this heart are jealousy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says qalb salim, is trying to say salim from this concept of jealousy and hatred towards one another. Amongst the understandings of the word salim also is al-ladigh. Al-ladigh. What's al-ladigh? Ladigh is basically bitten heart or a bitter heart. How does that make any sense? On that day, no one will be benefited by their children and their wealth except the one that comes with a bitter heart. How does that make any sense? Does it make any sense? Who wants to make sense of it for me? You, that came from Thorncliff. I guess. Huh? You have qalb salim. What does that mean? A pure heart. You have another understanding of the word salim, which means bitter. So how do you make sense of this in the context of this verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says on that day nor money nor children will help an individual except the one who comes with a bitter heart? That doesn't make any sense, does it? So make sense of it. Yalla. Huh?
Maybe it's an example.
No. Good try though.
Bitter towards all the use of the heart.
Very good try, but no. It could mean that as well, yeah. Kind of. Imam al-Junayd rahmatullah alayh, who was amongst the main people who taught the science of al-tazkiyah to the ummah, him and al-Harith al-Muhasabi, said that salim means over here bitter. And what it's trying to say is bitter because of the immense amount of fear that he has of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, when he was walking down by a shore, by a beach, he saw from a distance a furnace of fire. He was with Ibn Mas'ud. And when he saw this furnace of fire, Ibn Mas'ud recited the verse. He said, إِذَا رَأَتْهُمْ مِنْ مَكَانٍ بَعِيدٍ سَمِعُوا لَهَا تَزَيُّفًا وَزَفِيرًا. That when this fire, as in hellfire, sees the people that will be entering hellfire from a distance, they will hear for this fire the type of sound you hear when you're really close to fire. Tazayyuf. And a whistle. So Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he had a qalb salim, out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he fell unconscious. When Ibn Mas'ud said this verse, he fell unconscious, he couldn't take it. He saw the fire, the furnace, and he heard this verse, he put one and one together, and out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he couldn't take it, he just fell unconscious. And that's what the Qur'an should be doing to one of us. Of course, not falling unconscious, but it should be leading us to the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unless our hearts are extremely hard. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it a maw'idah. You go to the dars, you come to this class, you go to the khutbah, and you're seeking to be admonished by the lecturer, by the shaykh. Do you not remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. Verily, an admonishment has come from you, from your Lord, for you. The Quran. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. And also at the same time, it cures that which is within the hearts. So here it is, an example of a person who really had al-qalb al-salim, as in the one that is bitter out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is amongst the explanations of the word al-qalb al-salim. Al-qalb al-salim. With that being said, we're going to take a quick break. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ.